Welcome to today's Zoom talk with Professor John C. Welchman. I am Bolton Colburn, the curator of collections and exhibitions here at the Nora Eccles Harrison Museum of Art. And before I introduce Professor Welchman, I have a few words about the exhibition, Your Place in the Multiverse, Jean Lowe. The exhibition is a career survey of Jean's work, focusing on installations she has done over the past 17 years. The exhibition is currently at the Nora Eccles Harrison Museum of Art on the campus of Utah State University in Logan, Utah, where it will be up until December 12th. There is a 96-page publication which accompanies the exhibition with a central 20,000-word essay by John C. Welchman, and additional essays by Marissa Vignott, the USU Professor of Art History, and Katie Lee Coven, the Nora Eccles Harrison Museum of Art Executive Director and Curator of the exhibition. The book can be purchased by contacting the museum at NEHMA@usu.edu or by calling the museum at 435-797-0163. The exhibition has been made possible through the generous support of the Utah Division of Arts and Museums and Kim Robert McConnell. A virtual tour of the exhibition, along with audio comments by the artist, is available at NEHMA's website at artmuseum.usu.edu. A bit about today's talk, which we are doing in partnership with the Kane College of Art. It is structured to last 1 hour. Professor Welchman will speak for 45 minutes, after which we will have saved 10 minutes for questions from the audience. John C. Welchman is a distinguished professor of modern art history in the visual arts department at the University of California, San Diego. Some of his books include Modernism Relocated, Towards the Cultural Studies of Visual Modernity, published by Allen and Unwin in 1995. Invisible Colors, A Visual History of Titles, published by Yale University Press in 1997. Art After Appropriation, Essays on Art in the 1990s, published by Amsterdam, London, G plus B, Arts International, Rutledge, 2001. He is the co-author of Rethinking Borders, published by Minnesota University Press, Rutledge, 1996. Mike Kelly, Foul Perfection, Essays on Criticism, published by MIT Press in 2003. Mike Kelly, Minor Histories, Statements, Conversations, Proposals, published by MIT Press in 2004. Sculpture and the Vitrine, published by Henry Moore Institute, Ashgate in 2012. Professor Welchman is a founder and chair of the Southern California Consortium of Art Schools and editor of its publication series. He has co-authored The Data and Surrealist Image, published by Los Angeles County Museum of Art, MIT Press in 1989. Mike Kelly, published by Faden Contemporary Artists Series in 1999. Tony Orsler, published by Zurich J.R.P. Zingler in 2008. On the Beyond, a conversation between Mike Kelly, Jim Shaw, and John C. Welchman, published by Vienna and New York, Springwing, New York in 2011. And Joseph Kasuth, the second investigation, Media and Public Work, published by London Black Dog in 2012. With that, let me turn it over to Professor Welchman.
Great, thank you so much, Bolton, for that generous introduction. As Bolton said, I'm gonna share with you for about 45 or 50 minutes, and hopefully we'll have a few minutes at the end for some questions. Let me just share my screen.
You
There we are. Can you see that, Bolton?
Yes, looks good to me.
Super. So I want to begin today with a wonderful question posed by the writer, critic, poet, and wanderer, Ossip Mandelstam. What is the difference, he wrote in the 1920s, between a book and a thing? Now, hand-fabricated books first appeared in Jean Lowe's work almost two decades ago in 1993, when she received a commission to make a piece for the office of the innovative binational exhibition Insight in downtown San Diego, California. The room in question was quite small, she recalled, dominated by a huge, empty, built-in bookcase that caught her attention. Touching on a quality that has remained almost surreptitiously consistent all these years, Lowe's ever literalist orientation gave rise to the work you're looking at on screen, Pomp and Circumstance, 1993 to 94. A bookcase loaded with hand-confected papier-mâché tomes that she reckoned would lend the workspace a salutary dose of gravitas. Strictly governed by their, quote, size and heft, the content of some of the books, such as Grant Writing, which you can see at the top here, accorded somewhat seamlessly with the context, while others, Unwrapping Tut, Prozac and You, and Bulimia, The Ins and Outs, were what she described as head-scratcher pranks that complicated and subtly undermined the supposed propriety and decorum of an arts administration-denominated locale. With Pomp and Circumstance, the fundamental orientation of Lowe's books was immediately established. Concocted in flourishes of DIY improvisation, crudely smeared and splattered with drips and globs of enamel paint, some of Lowe's leafless books would appear at first glance to comport with the situation of their display, while others engaged in variously unstable gestures of misbehavior, subterfuge, or defiance. Their effects were cheeky, risky, unpredictable, and insouciant. This inaugural project also ushered in another defining characteristic associated with almost all of the artist's book-based projects, that her flaunted volumes work in tandem with other aspects of a particular decor or framing circumstance with which they subtly and reflexively interact. For Pomp and Circumstance, this was a series of facetiously replicated framed art awards, including recognition for outstanding leadership in the arts, which hung adjacent to an honor, you can see it on the left here, bestowed by the Laureleague Academy of Beauty. The following year, Lowe further consolidated the visual language of her books by producing her first tableau, in which a wide and cunningly conceived range of simulated volumes was organized on a dedicated bookcase in the appropriately titled exhibition, The Big Picture, from 1994. The basic orientation of the books thus established, Lowe worked through their governing parameters during the following years, accentuating an ever more resourceful and pointed interplay between cover, image, and title, text, creating more elaborate, humorous, and rebarbative modes of contextual activity, and working to expand the range and references of her decor and its material supports. She would develop shelves and books inspired by the old library at Schussenried Abbey in Germany, for example, a move precipitated by a dialogue with Candida Hofer's famous library photographs, but which at the same time opened up a specific vista in her no-holds-barred inquiry into formations of power and authority, here sustained by an unholy alliance operating in the cloisters of southern Germany between, quote, books beer, and God. Now, the material substrate of the artist's books based on papier-mâché followed, logically enough, from Lowe's earlier use of pulped paper, including for her collaborative work with Kim McConnell for Insight 1992, The Tale of the Bull, Cuentro del Toro, an installation featuring a giant Nandi, a Hindu gate guardian deity, at the Casa de la Cultura in Tijuana, Mexico. Struck by the forthright way that she was able to transform an idea into an object using this medium, Lowe went on to create the first of what would become another signature genre, a salon featuring papier-mâché furniture. You can see it on screen here, Accomplishments of Man, first seen at the Los Angeles Contemporary Exhibition Space, LACE, in 1993. Now, the books were a kind of conversational extrapolation from her material experiments. Commencing with a cardboard armature, she deploys clay-based wallpaper paste and strips of newspaper, or less frequently, old bedsheets, finishing the design with liberal applications of enamel paint, which she has substituted more recently with a beautiful flat cassin that lends itself to finer painting, because, quote, she couldn't handle the smell and toxicity anymore. One of the key ups of Lowe's accelerating ante was a further expansion in scale and reach that gave rise to full-blown libraries, such as Achieve and Maintain a More Powerful Delusion, first staged at the Rosamund Felsen Gallery in Los Angeles in 2007, which featured some 200 papier-mâché books in freestanding grids of bookshelves. The books were now ordered in unmarked but nevertheless discernible categories of the kind one might encounter under homemade signs in a used bookstore. Motivation and self-help, men's issues, men's interest, women's health and wellness, and a category that is always close to Lowe's heart, food and wine. Almost immediately, this move was creatively adulterated by the artist, who opted to, quote, let things ricochet around a bit more in an iteration at Mackenzie Fine Art in New York in 2008. So the titles were now hybridized, images insinuated and conversed with themselves off cover, and subject areas were creatively cross-contaminated. To some degree, Lowe's most recent inflection of her books, using bookshelf prints on polymetal, is a bid to rein in some of the unwanted arbitrariness and signifying chaos of her more freeform experiments in order to foreground certain, quote, unchangeable arrangements. Between 2004 and 2007, Lowe produced another book-denominated installation, her hilarious and satirical The Loneliness Clinic, a rambunctious simulation of a psychiatrist's waiting room and office, confected from life-size papier-mâché models of tables, chairs, a couch, an ottoman, paintings, along with magazine racks and shelves set with fabricated books, magazines, objects, and curios. Everything you might recall from a doctor's visit is here and waiting, and just a little larger and loopier than life, right down to the potted rubber plant, dog-eared journals, and an eccentric array of cast-off knickknacks. There's even a set of doctor's notes, normally off-limit to the anxious patient, recorded on papier-mâché notebooks with a mishmash of abbreviated diagnoses, mind-wandering asides, inappropriate sexualized doodles, and inapposite notes to the self by popcorn. Now, the design ethos of the Loneliness Clinic is a pervasive mid-century modernism in the manner of the Eames brothers, the Corbusier, Mies van der Rohe, and George Nelson. But, as you can see, all its salubriousness and voguish chic is humbled down if never quite, evacuated by a fabrication process that's palpably handmade, and a ubiquitous finish in glossy metal that, sorry, glossy enamel, that converts the context into a panorama of cartoon vulgarity. Lowe has ripped the seams and not the stuffing out of an aesthetic predicated on pristine tubular steel, color-coordinated leathers, and showroom finish. And in the process, she seems to have visualized and made concrete in a symptomatic blind spot the very institution of mental health. And one of the chief means by which the waiting room exacts revenge on its occupants is founded in the artist's wittily elaborate gestures of renomination. Lowe conjures a dissident semantics from the array of books and magazines in the waiting room and office by derailing their conventional significations of professional competence or consumerist distraction, and substituting a sly commentary on the culture of narcissism. For the Incheon International Women's Biennial in 2007, Lowe's shelves included a range of new titles and notepads in the Korean Hangul script. Now, Lowe's installation presumes the existence of a backstage persona whose discursive presence is everywhere implied by her creative interference with design and ambience. For the Loneliness Clinic is also a projective fantasy based on the implied biography of her absent protagonist, a certain Dr. Powhatan. The unseen psychiatrist is brought into being only by the viewer's distracted interaction with an array of surrogate personal and professional objects. Following the existential deliberations of the mid-20th century, by Beckett in Waiting for Godot, among others, the work offers another form of mediation on the psychodynamics of waiting, a serio-comic inquiry into the inscrutable occupation of those odd brackets around time into which we enter when waiting for medical services in a hospital, a clinic, or general practice. The work of the persona is made over into a rethinking of the time spent waiting for him to appear. There are a few areas of life, I think, in which we are put on hold in a context that at the same time purports to put us at ease by simulating the communality of domestic space. Lowe has caught the familiarity of this arena by the horns, flipped over its neutrality, and reactivated the very anxieties it was designed to quell. The space and time otherwise killed or tranquilized by the situational normativity of the waiting room are here offered a salient resurrection. But they come back with a life of their own, administering to the clients and passers-by a salutary dose of what Salvador Lee once termed critical paranoia, as their environment turns humorously hostile by interpreting them back. Now, by now, Lowe has produced hundreds of books in dozens of shapes, sizes, and categories, addressing a myriad of subjects and issues. Ideas for her volumes, her series, her thematic installations, arrive from many directions, including from the routines of daily life, as, for example, when she happened upon a beat-up car with a huge spoiler parked on a local street, which inspired the work on screen, Spoiler Alert, with its cover image of a black spoiler-bedecked hearse. More commonly, she works up ideas in, quote, batches by leafing through magazines, some recent, others culled from her childhood and adolescence, or by poring over academic press announcements and trawling for titles in a wide spectrum of art historical and other studies. For a permanent installation of books at the University of California, San Francisco, China Basin campus, for example, she studied scientific book titles, not that she notes that's, quote, obvious. As Lowe negotiates these contexts, sometimes an image drives the title. On other occasions, it's the other way around. Like a crossword puzzle addict, however, the cumulative effect of these exercises in stretching the mind has produced a dexterous capacity to shift, twist, and recombine elements from a vast reservoir of words, cliches, and images into a phantasmagoria of pithy, mordant, or darkly humorous titles. Now, one of the things that makes Lowe's book so distinctive is that she appears to have sidestepped almost all of the more obvious place markers set down for experimentation with the format of the book in avant-garde art since the turn of the 20th century. While she experiments quite excitedly with hand-marked scripts, fonts, calligraphy, Lowe is not fundamentally interested in the typographic investigations associated with that salient genealogy of innovations that commences with Stéphane Mallarmé, includes the futurist parole in libertà on the left here, words in freedom, and culminates in the work of the Letterist International in the 1940s and 50s. Her books might have more in common, perhaps, with the play and caprice of the artists associated with the Fluxus movement during the 1960s, but their commitment to a stubborn one-offism is at odds with the collective and participatory engagements, loose though they often were, of this and subsequent movements. Further, the characteristic products of Fluxus, boxes contain multiples by way parts and subparts meted out as aggregates, is wholly at odds with the uncompromising block-like solidity and frank singularity of Lowe's tomes. Interested, to be sure, in questions of order, sequence, arrangement, and temporality, as well as writing by hand, Lowe's work also has little real relation, I think, to the conceptual abstraction of Hannah Darboven's numerological tables, even when her formats of presentation on graph paper or index cards are corralled into pseudo book-like formulas, as here in Ein Jahrhundert, a century, a work produced between 1971 and 75, which visualizes a 100-year time span through numbers apportioned to 365 binders arranged on shelves. Perhaps the approach that's closest to Lowe's in the contemporary art world is also closest to home. Produced in a studio 100 or so miles north, beginning just a couple of years after Lowe's first books, Jim Shaw's paperback covers, which he made between 1996 and 2013, also ape the scale and dimensions of the soft cover publications he appears to simulate along with publisher logos. But Shaw's covers eschew the most vital forces, I think, that animate Lowe's, including title and author, concentrating instead on highly condensed dreamlike narrative images that refer crypto-allegorically to, and even at times stand in for, his own autobiography. More oneric, more dreamlike and self-referring, Shaw's covers share with Lowe's books a mode of serial accumulation that illuminates a parallel world of graphic art, illustration, and the abundant pop cultural declensions of printed matter. But if Shaw produces symbolic landscapes redolent of the pressures on his own artistic becoming, Lowe's work, more critically and corrosively, acts on the fault lines and dissipations of the culture of categories themselves, and the desire, narcissism, prurience, and oblivion that underscores them. Now, clearly, the Lowe Library offers a riposte in spades and in kind to the era of the cheap mass distribution paperback by confecting volumes in papier-mâché so that with a kind of lumpen equal opportunity, they take over the front, middle, and back of the simulated books she fabricates, at the same time converting their high volume serial runs into unique standalone objects. But while the pulp fiction they broker wittily skewers the facile opportunism of some aspects of the contemporary publishing industry with its endless niche markets, DIY, wellness, self-help, potted philosophy, career advice seen here, and a thousand other topical platitudes, and both exploits and confronts the depredations of the mall-bound chain store discount rack. There's something else at stake in Lowe's books that uses the crass commercialism of these contexts as much as an exit vehicle than as a point of commencement. I want to suggest that for all their critical, sardonic, even petulant energy, for all their throwaway tilts and crackling slapstick wit leveled at and around the unstoppable force of contemporary consumer culture, Lowe's signature volumes are heir to an older, perhaps even more defining tradition associated with avant-garde art in the early years of the 20th century. They build, materially and conceptually, on the pasted papers or papier-collé revolution of the early 1910s, which also ushered in a new attention to words and writings as found objects in the newspaper ads and articles appropriated by Pablo Picasso and Georges Braque in their early collages, as well as precipitants of stencils and templates. But Lowe's books also inherit something of the mirage they conjure from a predominantly literary innovation that developed in parallel with the Cubist Revolution, though is seldom aligned with it. The establishment of what we can call, for the sake of abbreviation, magic realism, a way of reanimating the everyday world so that its solid objects and settled characteristics, admixed with dreams, marvels, nostalgia, and riotous opinion, morph unstably into dimensions of appearance and displaced purpose that are quite other. Associated with Marc Chagall and some aspects of surrealism in experimental art, this genealogy is clearer, perhaps, in the literary avant-garde, where it might be said to begin with Franz Kafka and Ossip Mandelstam himself, make its way through the writings of William Faulkner and Jorge Luis Borges, and come to a kind of climax in the writings of Julio Cortázar, Italo Calvino, and Gabriele García Márquez. While almost all of these authors explore, and not occasionally explode, the idea and form of the book, as well as its volatile palpability, I want to dwell a little on the most intricate and fragrant of these transporting disquisitions, that of the writings of Ossip Mandelstam. For the force and direction of Mandelstam's deliciously wayward bibliomanic imagination orbits the world of books on a trajectory, the arcs and decays of which are preternaturally aligned with Lowe's, beginning with his wry observation about the repetition compulsion, reading and reading, associated with an exuberant variant of one of Lowe's favorite shibboleths. He writes of harmful, foolish books, quote, filled with mysticism, hysteria, and all manner of pathology, and how his protagonist, quote, struggled with them. He settled accounts with them, but he could never tear himself away from them and forever kept coming back. Mandelstam's prose, like Lowe's making, is caught up in an almost preposterous reverie, precipitated by the immediate tactile and sensational properties of books. This is sometimes color denominated, as with the quote, whole piles of little blue volumes, 8, I think it was, quote, fetched for him in an Armenian library, or the quote, little brown volumes by Russian and foreign authors, their contagious pages so red they seemed made of silk, end quote, ferried to the beach by members of his household in summertime, and the quote, reddish 5-volume works with ragged covers he recalled from his childhood, populating the shelves of his parents' emblematic bookcase. But Mandelstam also calibrates his experience of books physically in terms of sheer weight or mass. He recalls the huge encyclopedic volumes that crushed bookstands and card tables in his era, single and multi-volume miscellanies like Universal Panorama or Virgin Soils. These were epistemological totalities, true fonts of knowledge of all the world, end quote, and little universes unto themselves, characterized by images that were set out with unusual specificity and proto-surrealist intimations. Quote, Malayan swimmers bound to boards and skimming through waves the size of a three-storied house. Now, answers to the bombastic omnibi of Soviet encyclopedism with its distracted revisionist overreach by debunking the theoretical accretions of her own era, manifest above all in a categorically challenged 20-volume edition of the writings of the arch-priest of post-structuralism, Michel Foucault, Foucault on Bull. In the five volumes of the haplessly compromised A Search for Moral Values, dedicated to family, God, country, eBay, and outlet malls. And in her abrasive retort to Big Pharma by way of Pfizer's proprietary custom-published pharmaceutical solutions, with volumes dedicated to boredom, grandiosity, disappointment, loneliness, and grief, as well as lice, erectile dysfunction, and athlete's foot. Mandelstam's projected imagination puts the very scale and substance of books at stake, but at the same time attributes to them an overweening, almost imperialist reach. Books, he writes, melt like chunks of ice brought into a room. Everything grows smaller. Everything seems to me a book, a meditation that is quickly converted into a tart morsel of philosophical speculation that echoes quite precisely one of the fundamental questions posed by Lowe. Where is the difference between a book and a thing? Not surprisingly, Mandelstam draws out the strength and conviction brokered by books, a center of gravity he otherwise corrosively short circuits, in a metaphor that draws them directly alongside the project of painting. Quote, out of the whole material world, of all physical bodies, a book is the one object that inspires man with the greatest degree of confidence. When a book is firmly established on a reader's desk, it is like a canvas stretched on a frame. But Lowe, of course, stages this operation in reverse. Instead of likening books to paintings or drawing them onto canvas, she brings painting into the very form and appearance of the book, invoking in the process an absent third term, as they are now made over as sculpture. In an even more uncanny resemblance to Lowe's project, which spins its own sticky web of humorously self-deprecating references, Mandelstam too launches a whole litany of outlandish anthropomorphic correlations, the widest aperture of which is the categorization of humankind itself by way of publication types, which happen to be the very outcomes and medium pulped paper used by the artist. Some men, he writes, are books. Others are newspapers. Certain classes of people then, such as the raznochinnik, Russian, an intellectual associated with none of the principal social classes, such as the nobility, the priesthood, or the merchants. These raznochinnik need no memory, he asserts. It is enough for them to tell of the books they have read, and their biography is done, end quote. The characterological thread in Mandelstam's thinking prompts him, like Lowe, to come to terms with the books in his milieu, with a caricatural bent, emphasizing the ways in which they exaggerate, distort, and concoct, and placing a premium on their most literal and garish visibilities. Both writer and artist reserve special consideration for the overlay between books and food. For Lowe, This is egged on under the cover of her special hot sauce of enamel flourishes and painterly dribbles as she takes on the dysfunctional endgame of the food industrial complex and pronounces with her recognizable menu of relish and jaw-dropping disdain on food-related allegories, disorders, 21st century diets, and sundry edible taboos. Slasher movies, A Vegan's Dilemma, The IBS Cookbook, The Battered Women's Cookbook, Bulimics Digest. A good measure of the offbeat syncopation between Lowe and Mandelstam can be found in the telling details of their mutual discourse on vegetables and vegetarianism. Mandelstam assails, quote, the vegetable obedience of the corps de ballet, alluding simultaneously to the servile order of the dance company and the emaciated figures it presses into service. He witheringly castigates a certain philologist in the Herzen House, an empty acolyte of Soviet rectitude, as a milksop vegetarian. And, recalling a journey along the Smolensk Highway, observes that the truck farmers' allotments were populated by, quote, pale green cabbage bombs heaped up in godless abundance, reminding him of the triangular pile of skulls in Vasily Vereshchagin's painting, The Apotheosis of War from 1871, which you can see here. Further shaking down this line of thinking, Van Gogh's paintings of nature are to him nothing more than streetcar conductors' vegetable garden landscapes, quote, rendered in, quote, cheap vegetable pigment bought by accident for 20 cents. Now, these wrinkled, pickled put-downs are a Potemkin's village of detours and ciphers that throw into relief the meaty immediacy of another imagination, which finds a less gamey echo, of course, in Lowe's Tender Pork or 666 Ways to Prepare Goat Meat. This imagination sprung from books piled on a satrap's table that, quote, take on the taste of pink pheasant meat, bitter quails, musky venison, and roguish hare, end quote. They are also the deferred wish fulfillments of Lowe's latter-day vegan's dilemma. They consort with the coruscating irony which gives vent to the creepy candlelight coupling of romantic vegan delights and the high society anthems of the special occasion vegan. They come home to roost or simmer, crossed with moral flavored theology in the tempting vegetable medley on the cover of What Would Satan Eat? While the similar cornucopia of beets, peas, carrots, and root vegetables fronting tasty dishes from waste items proffers an unlikely alliance between the altruisms of recycling and of the body's own waste and replenishment and the shallow masquerade of a gourmandisme that converts taste to tasty. Lowe's most lapidary one word title on the subject sums it up. That's nutritainment. I'd like to spend the remaining minutes of my time with you reflecting just a bit on the excellent exhibition that's up in the Nora Eccles Harrison Museum of Art and its accompanying catalog. First of all, I'd like to offer a wholehearted thanks to Katie Lee Coven, curator of the exhibition and the museum's executive director and chief curator, and to the curator of collections and exhibitions, Bolton Colburn, who not only reached out with a commission for the essay I wrote, but generously allowed me to write quite a long text attempting to situate Lowe's work, as I feel it has not been previously, in relation to an important range of questions raised in 20th century critical theory about commodity and commercial culture. I took the opportunity of threading Lowe's work quite intricately through a series of relationships with what is the most poetic, but also one of the most challenging books written by Theodore Adorno, Minima Moralia, Reflections from Damaged Life, published in 1951. With his characteristic erudition and rhetorical panache, Adorno created a sequence of brief, pithy entries governed, like Lowe's fake tomes, by deliciously elusive titles to take on a range of problems, diagnoses, questions, and prophecies based in large part on his encounter with American consumer culture during his sojourn in the United States, mostly in Los Angeles, between 1938 and 1953. Time and again, Adorno pointed to motifs, ideas, emblems, and conceits in popular, everyday, and high culture that correspond to or dramatically illuminate Lowe's own methods and examples. Lowe must therefore be counted as one of those who creates a mirage of materialized compartmentalizations in order to offer, quote, something which is one of a kind, which no one wants to buy anymore, end quote, as Adorno put it, and who thereby represents, quote, even against their will, freedom from exchange. A parallel measure of that, quote, freedom arrives by way of the artist's engagement with the moral critique of consumer culture, with social narcissism, the exhausted economies of surplus, and their symbolic objects, locations, and styles, which is, as several commentators have observed, predicated more on dry, sardonic humor, leavened with guile and cunning, than shrill, preachy, or otherwise orchestrated vehemence. She offers, as the New York Times Review presciently put it in 2008, quote, a fun house mirror reflection of the American consciousness industry, warts, blind spots, and all. And of course, it is that term, the consciousness industry, that's very much associated with the thinking of Theodore Adorno and the Frankfurt School. Now, the uncanny congruence between Adorno and Lowe begins, of course, in their respective meditations on books and bookcases themselves, the subject of a vigorous section of Minima Moralia. Here, Adorno writes of the prevalence of false consciousness within an emergent neoliberal dispensation, something that's most visible, he claims, by way of that element of decor most definitively associated with unself-reflective free thinking, the bookshelf. In the space of just a few lines, Adorno produces an astonishingly pertinent description of the nature, types, and appearances of Lowe's self-publishing industry, at the same time glimpsing unmistakably at its wider deconstructive purpose and its rib-cracking wit. Quote, on the bookshelf, we might find derivative works on socialism and psychoanalysis and a little sex research for the uninhibited with inhibitions, end quote. He points to the conspicuously reduced prices of mass editions and to the compact economic form, as he puts it, of the omnibus or multi-volume series. Created in 2003 and shown in Los Angeles and New York the following year, Empire Style, which I've summarized on the screen here, offers one of the most dramatic of the collisions Lowe has staged between the constructions of history and commercial contemporaneity, clashes and amalgamations between styles and modes of appearance, overlays and incommensurabilities between fine and decorative art, all running along the frayed edges she posits between appearance, illusion, simulation, and the arbitration of deceit. Empire Style makes over a largest exhibition room into an ersatz salon set with hand-fabricated replicas of period furniture and decorative objects from the Napoleonic era, roughly 1800 through 1815. A flecked mahogany commode, green and red armchairs, gold side chairs, a clock modeled after Jacques-Louis David's famous painting, The Oath of the Horatii, another allegorical timepiece, warrior clock, a sauce boat, and a console with hooves. The center of the space is occupied by a carpet suffused with imperial, you can see it here on the left, suffused with imperialist iconography based on an empire period Aubusson rug, while the walls are ordered by assorted wainscoting and decorated with huge wallpaper-like murals featuring vistas of sundry big box outlets that were, and mostly still are, the paradigmatic built structures associated with American suburban malls, Walmart, Del Taco, KFC, Pizza Hut. We find our way into all of this by a sight-only encounter with Lowe's awkwardly soldered and jointed paint-engorged furniture and accoutrements, which seem to simmer and foam in their resting places around the walls of the room, exuding postules of decorative whimsy, fired up by a spectrum of clamorously gaudy enamel color. Yet, the artist's adjudication of our encounter is pitch perfect, allowing us from a certain distance and in general reproductions to mistake the fake decor for the real thing, to experience a kind of confusion or blurriness as we get nearer, and then an epiphany as we finally realize the stage enormity and hard-won cornball crudity of the dissimulation. The elliptical focal range of the work is matched by a similar finesse with respect to its negotiation with the key details of historical style itself, as each of the elements of the empire style, the console, the figurative clock, the carpet, the wallpapers, are subject to a beguiling range of research and redevelopment, which I detail in the catalogue essay, each subtly predicated on the central characteristics of empire style itself, with its pursuit of relentless mimicry, exchange, appropriation, and substitution. The critic and historian of French furniture, Roger de Felice, notes that, quote, plaster takes the place of marble. Paper plays at being painting. Pasteboard mimics the labors of the graving, the engraving tool. Glass takes the place of precious stones. Varnish simulates porphyry, end quote. It could be said of the style Lowe has purloined that, quote, in furniture, as in other things, the era of the counterfeit is beginning. Lowe thus makes good on the legacy of palpable falsehood and its rhetoric in an era defined by the sublime overdetermination of fakery. Lowe's elaborately confected dual function papier-mâché replica piano, seen here, presented on a simulated Persian carpet, was first exhibited at Quint Gallery in 2005 as part of Grand Tour, and again in Santa Monica, later in New York, in the artist's 2007 exhibition, Achieve and Maintain a More Powerful Delusion. Proposed by the artist as a relay of generosity, by means of which, quote, debased high culture meets immediate gratification, Baby Grand's split singularity lights a slow fuse that focuses and ignites Lowe's thinking about the ricochet of signification around the symbolic forms of commodity and domestic objects. Operating in a duplicitous space quite at odds with the pianistic sentimentality of the 19th and early 20th century, still residual in paintings of women at the piano by the intimists Pierre Bonnard, Edouard Vuillard, and Henri Matisse, including Young Woman at the Piano from around 1925, seen here, and a similar work from the previous year. Lowe repurposes this defining token of bourgeois culture, looking instead to various deconstructions of the piano's historical and literal qualities initiated by Dali in the 1930s, as you can see here, and taken up in more material and destructivist gestures by Ralph Montagnez Ortiz and an accomplice who destroyed a piano with axes at the Destruction in Art Symposium in London, organized by Gustav Metzger in 1966, and later by the conceptual rethinking of the collective known as slave pianos. More on this in the catalogue. For Lost Time, first shown in Santa Monica in 2014, Lau creates pages for odd and job lots that might have appeared in the catalogues of ephemera or local estate auctions. The excerpted pages appear as inkjet prints presented on polymetal supports, laid out so as to emulate the format of an auction listing, including the item header and brief description with a designated category for the item or the lot, a starting price or expected bidding range, date or period indication, provenance, and sometimes a longer description furnishing further contextual, historical, material, or generic information. The objects thus posted for sale are also made visible in crudely simulated physical form, as Lau fabricates handmade versions presented in museological file cabinets, the drawers of which are left open for viewing. Lost Time reports not only on things that have disappeared or been mislaid, including, as headlined in the remarkable titular notice from 1850, Time itself, but also on how objects are reallocated according to the logic of different systems of value and display. Now, many of these objects are common items, a half-trashed subway beverage cup, an American Airlines air sickness bag, the cover of an edition of AT&T's August 2011, The Real Yellow Pages, targeted for area codes in North San Diego County, where Lau lives and works. Items not normally associated with, let alone allocated to, the category of art. The values we might impute to these things are resoundingly utilitarian, promotional, voyeuristic, or informational, and none are associated with the kind of archival, documentary, or collectible status that would occasion their formalized and decontextualized resale. Most of the other listed items are text inscribed, whether the three yellow notepads with offhandedly scurrilous doctor's notes, as here, we've come across these before, a pair of office memos from a certain Zach and Ezekiel on Life Extension Technologies letterhead, three captioned newspaper photos from a 1948 spread in Life magazine, revealing the deleterious effects of a Hawaiian ball, a three-paragraph Reuters news clipping about an accidental death in Sweden, facsimiles of eight of Lau's California driving licenses, posted notices about a lost dog, and more meta-referentially, the ad I mentioned earlier, dated January 3, 1850, offering a reward for the retrieval of various increments of hours and minutes amounting to several days of lost time. Now, there are a few examples in the art world, I think, of the annexation of this kind and range of defiantly quotidian material. Perhaps the closest case of something similar arrives in the work of the Los Angeles-based artist Mike Kelly, who deployed a vast field of popular cultural materials, including several of the same elements that Lau has put to work in Lost Time. Posters for lost pets, you can see one of these in the center here. Vintage newspaper clippings and notices, notably in his photographic series Timeless Authorless from 1995, where they underscore a sense of historical believability. Fast food cups and containers, part of Kelly's singles mixer, one of the episodes in Day is Done, is shown in the center here alongside two related works by Lau. And even the same range of notes scrawled on doctor's letterhead. Like Lau, Kelly also invested the conditions of temporality and its forfeits, assembling one strand of this inquiry under the heading, as we've seen, Missing Time, part of his ambitious career-long investigation into the relations between time, memory, and art. Kelly's exhibition and associated essay on Missing Time turns on the legacy of training, apprenticeship, and influence, simultaneously repressed and sanctified by modernist art history. It offers a challenging reflection on the formation of artistic style and iconography that makes visible the blizzard of indoctrination, fashion, chance, obsession, and repression through which they somehow emerge. And at the same time, questions the very constitution of memory by examining the conflicted legacy of repressed memory syndrome. Despite the presence of simulated driver's license with their portrait gallery of Lowe's institutionally mediated appearance over the last four or so decades, lost time is not so closely orchestrated around social and artistic formation as Keller's reflections in Missing Time and elsewhere. Perhaps this divergence is marked by the difference between time that is missing and time that seems more definitively, quote, lost. So if Kelly makes an art-mediated bid somehow to replace time that has gone astray, or at least to speak to, even account for, the nature of its absence or gaps, Lowe points to a more definitive sense of loss, which in turn, humorously mitigated by the lack of gravitas and apparent randomness of the objects assembled for sale. Ultimately, she notes, in her role as rug merchant for the fabric of society, quote, value, monetary and otherwise, could be seen as randomly ascribed to objects and actions. Thank you.
Thank you, John. That was great. You really covered the exhibition pretty well. You stopped at POW, which is good, because we're close to having used all our time. But for those of you in the audience that would like to ask a question, if you go to your raise hand icon below on your bar and press that, we will unmute you and you can ask your questions.
Yeah, happy to take a few questions if you all have them. Ah. Hello, Marissa. I think you're muted still. Maybe you have to unmute yourself. Yeah.
Oh, there we go. Okay, it was giving me multiple options. Am I good now?
Yep, we can hear you. That's all fine.
Perfect, okay. Thank you so much, John. I really appreciate your talk today, and I really look forward to talking to my students about it some more when we meet. I'm really wondering, just from my own interest in Lowe's work and my personal experiences with her and seeing this exhibition, for you, what role, like the bodily and pleasure, comes in to play with this, and also humor, because everything is so funny with her works. And for me, that so pushes against a kind of serious intellectualizing of modernist art history, which is present in these works, particularly in the way that they call back to that, but that they also kind of hit us again with something that reminds us of something very anti-Adorno, in that like there is pleasure in the world and there is pleasure to be taken from experiencing these things and consuming these things and existing in these spaces.
Yeah, well, thank you. Two questions there, very big ones. The role of the body and the role of humor and the comedic and satire and parody, all of which I think are present in Jean's work. Let me maybe emphasize the second and come back to the first if we have some time. I think the reason I took on the approach that I did in the long catalog essay, slightly less so, I would say, in this lecture, I actually, you know, I looked and reviewed the literature on Jean Lowe's work, and you know, it's rich and it's interesting, but most of it actually sort of signals a willingness to disengage with some of the bigger issues around commodity culture and commodity critique. And I just wanted to turn the tables. I think in turning the tables, I freely confess that, you know, it's possible to have gone a little bit far in the opposite direction. But because there was almost nothing that, you know, just to put it very crudely, was taking Lowe's work seriously in relation to a range of questions that I feel even a male artist having posed work of this nature, like Mike Kelly, right, whose iconography is very similar and whose mordant, you know, wit and sarcasm is also quite analogous, I think, to some of the things that Lowe takes on. But that work has been or would be taken much more seriously. And I wanted to do that job, because I think when you look particularly at the complexity of the interrelation between the different projects over the years, and that's what the show, like, you know, that's the kind of thing that the show at the museum at the moment can actually do, right? We're not just looking at a one-off book or a one-liner joke about something, which is very much how I think Lowe's work has been received in the past. But there are, you know, there's a very complex network of interrelations in her negotiation with history, going back to the Empire style and going back further than that, in her negotiation with questions around appropriation and commodity critique that just have not been set out. So I just wanted to do that. I wanted to give the work an opportunity to take its place within and across and against, to a certain extent, a certain way that commodity critical work has been positioned. Mm-hmm.
That's great, thank you.
And in terms of the body, maybe I could just say a word about that. I mean, I think the nature of the book is to produce a form of disembodiment that simulates and reconceives and rearbitrates relations that cross back again through the imagination, through projection, through fantasy, through the erotic, back to the body. And I think that Lowe's work, particularly in the book format, has played out a very subtle dialogue between modes of bodily experience and the false modalities of body constructs. And I think that the work does both. And so what interests me is how you have access onto a certain framework of the body as a formation of pleasure. But at the same time, probably you have to say the most pointed sort of object of Lowe's critique or humorous parody are the kinds of body culture, popular body culture book formations that we see in every bookstore we go into, whether you know, ridiculously overextended, extenuated, frameworks for the organization of that form of knowledge that just, I think, don't have the liberty within their own spacing to come out with the kinds of jubilation or release that you might see in another aspect of body culture.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Well, great, John. Thank you so much for doing such a complete scholarly job on Jean's work. We have really appreciated it here at the museum, and the publication's going to be around for a long time. Which it's a great tribute to Jean and her work and her placement within art and art theory. So thank you very much for your contribution.
Yeah, it's a pleasure, Bolton. And I wholeheartedly agree with what you've just said. It's a terrific opportunity for folks in the area to see this marvelous show, and the book, I hope, will take wings and travel as Lowe's books do and should.
Great. Thanks again.
Okay, thank you all.